mine that are visiting, learning in yeshiva. Where do they meet my uncle? One of them met him in this office, this diplomatic office. This one just on the street. How did they meet my uncle? Because he was always happy and always looking to help another. If anybody ever looked in distress, he was there to offer assistance. Because that's who my uncle was. When he was living in Hawaii, because he was the most educated in that area, he actually acted as the rabbi. He went and officiated over bar mitzvahs. I think he might have done a wedding, but anytime he could be of assistance, my uncle was that person. How can I help you? What can I do? And when I think of the message of Rav Kook, and I ask, how are we going to turn this day into a day of happiness? If only we all could take that message from my uncle. It's not a matter of needing a reason, but we see another human being, we see the beautiful neshama, and we approach them, we say, how can I help? How can I treat you as a human being with offering you dignity? Because through Ahavat Chinam, that is the only way that we can counter all the hatred that we've been experienced in this world. And for me, that's a way for me to continue the legacy of my uncle. At this point, it brings me a lot of warmth. Maybe I shouldn't say that on Tisha B'Av, but, and it's a privilege to be able to introduce somebody who's become so dear in my life. Somebody who had a similar experience to my uncle, but thank God stands here today to tell her story. A story I know that if my uncle were able to share this special vantage of life that we can only dream of, I believe he would be so quick to join her by her side. Every year, if not on the yard site, as well as the Yom HaZikaron, we make sure to always have a long conversation, if not get together. And it's in that vein that for me, to help me remember my uncle and to share with you some of those special messages and morals and ideals in life. Give me a second. I'd like to call up a dear friend, Sarri Singer.
It's really an honor for me to speak not only on Tisha B'Av, but in a community that I spent a lot of time when I was in high school. I spent a lot of time at NCSY Shabbatons here. I spent a lot of time in the Chudnoff's home for weekends. And so whenever I speak in a place where it's something of a memory, it's always such an honor for me to be able to share my story, because my story really represents thousands of people in Israel and thousands of people around the world who have been affected by terrorism. And before I begin, can I take this off? Okay, before I begin, I definitely would like to introduce and thank my mother for being here. She's always around and very supportive of any of my speaking engagements, and when it's in the area, it's always easier. So I just want to thank her for being here. I'm gonna start off a little bit differently than I have when I've spoken in the past. And the reason is because today is Tisha B'Av, but today is also another memory for me. 10 years ago, on August 9th, 2001, I was running a summer program in Israel for about 100 high school students, 10th and 11th grade. And on the morning of August 9th, I was fighting with my co-director because we were up north and he was gonna go back to Jerusalem to work on the DVD that we were surprising the kids with to bring home. And I wanted to go work on the DVD. And we fought about it and finally said, fine, you can go. And I said, okay, if I'm going, I want to bring a friend with me. So I brought one of our staff members, if anybody knows Marlon Glazer, and we ended up in Jerusalem midday. And we were going to go to Sparrow's for lunch. And I said to Aaron, let's go to Har HaChutzim. Let's go to the high-tech center where we were going. Let's get the work done first, and then we'll go and have food. I was always very focused on getting the job done first. And so we ended up in Har HaChutzim. About 20 minutes after we arrived, all of a sudden the office we were in, and there were only about five or six people in the office, all of our cell phones went off at the same time. And we didn't understand what was happening. We all picked up our phones and they said, did you hear? Are you okay? I said, what are you talking about? There was just an attack, a terrorist attack at Sparrow's, and we knew you guys were going there for lunch. Where are you guys? Are you okay? And we were all very, very shaken up by this, knowing that we could have been there. And we waited to hear before we made our way back up north to the rest of the group. And we had to, of course, do some control in terms of speaking to parents in the States. And on that day, unfortunately, a family that was originally 10 lost eight family members. Sorry, lost five family members. The Skyva Shooter family, from originally from Holland, who had made Aliyah, they were in Sparrow's with three of their children, the three youngest, and the other children were not there that day. There was a family, the Roth family, their daughter Maki, you may have heard of. Maki was also killed. She had gone out to lunch with her friend Michal, and I've become close with the Roth family in Israel, especially the father. They have an organization in memory of Maki. And that day really affects me very strongly. And although you're in Israel, you don't always know when an attack is happening, you still feel what's going on in Israel because everybody else is feeling it. But the next day you come to an area where there's an attack and it doesn't sometimes even look like there was an attack. Because the resilience and the idea in Israel is that everything needs to get back in order as quickly as possible. Things need to be running the way they should. And so by the next week, when we had brought the group back into Jerusalem, you would have never even thought that anything had happened in this spot. But when I came back to the States 3 weeks later, I still was shaken up by what had happened in Israel, because in all the times that I had been there, college vacations, when I studied there for a year, there was nothing that had impacted me like this to think I could have been there. And then, of course, we all remember September 11th. And on that morning, I was in my apartment. And I had overslept. I lived on the Upper West Side. And I got up in the morning to turn on the TV to see the weather. And I saw the towers burning. And I thought it was a joke. And I called my office immediately, and they said, don't bother coming in, we're being evacuated. And I realized on that day that we are not safe anywhere. Here I just come from Israel, where the attacks were basically beginning of the second intifada. And now I came back to New York, to a place where it's a melting pot of people, where everybody can feel free to come and do what they need to and not be in fear. And then the 9/11 attacks happened. And I stayed in my apartment for 3 days. I didn't leave. I remember calling my parents, and they both said, don't come home. We don't know if something's going to happen over the bridge or in the tunnels. Stay where you are. And we couldn't go back to work for about 3 or 4 weeks. And so we definitely worked in different areas. But I remember so clearly that the city was not the same, especially that next month. I could smell the smells of the burning coming from downtown over 100 blocks away. And I felt very antsy about what was going on. I felt like something had to change. I needed to do something. And when I finally returned to work, I remember I couldn't get off the subway stop that I used to get off, which was, there were two stops I used to take. Either I would get off right across the street from the World Trade Center, or I'd get off on Broadway, which was around the corner from the World Trade Center. And those subways were completely destroyed and they needed to be refixed. So you had to get off of Chambers Street, which is about 10 or 12 blocks away from my office. My office was 11 Broadway. If anyone knows downtown Manhattan, it's right by the Bull. So it was really down at the end, about 2 blocks away from the World Trade Center. And I remember getting out of the subway and walking to work and seeing lines and lines of people. And I went to one of them and I said, what are you doing? And they said, oh, we're online to take a picture to see where the World Trade Center used to stand. And I thought, this is terrible. It's a month later. People are still roaming the streets in downtown Manhattan looking for their loved ones. They're